Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you all for being here. Guests especially, thank you for choosing to worship with us. There's a lot of places you could be, and the fact that you are here is something we very much appreciate and do not take for granted. Now, as you can see, we're starting out this week with the best way to start a worship service, and that is with baptism. In fact, we're going to have three baptisms this morning, and what you're going to see here is a physical picture of a spiritual reality. The moment that a person repents of their sins and places their faith in Jesus Christ, we share in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In fact, the book of Romans says that we are buried with him in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. And so what you're going to see is as the candidate goes under the water, it pictures death. And as they come up, it pictures the resurrection. It pictures life. That's why we baptize like we do. As Baptists, we are dunkers. That's what we are. And so that's the picture there of the death, burial, and resurrection. And so let me say this. If you are a believer and you have never been baptized, and this can happen, come talk to me after service. It's one of the most important things that you can do to tell the world that you belong to Christ. So we have several candidates for baptism today. And the first one is Ethan Thorne. Ethan, you want to come on down? Very good. All right, Ethan, I'm going to ask you a question. Have you repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus as Lord?
Yes.
Based on that profession of faith, I baptize you as my brother in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, very good. Our next candidate is Melinda Medlin. Melinda, you want to come on down? All right, Melinda, I'm asking you the same question. Have you repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus as Lord?
Yes, sir.
All right, based on that profession of faith, I baptize you as my sister in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I just soaked my shoes. It's all right, we got one more, and we're good. Our third candidate today is Bryant Dacus. Bryant, you want to come on down? Bryant, I want to ask you the same question. Have you repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus as Lord?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Well, I baptize you as my brother in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Well, good morning. Let's begin by singing. Would you stand with us, please, as we sing Wonderful Words of Life? Sing them over again to me, Wonderful Words of Life. Let me more of their beauty see, Wonderful Words of Life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty, Beautiful Words, Wonderful
Good morning, church. As you can see, I'm not Brother Adam or Brian or Brother John, because he soaked his shoes. But today I'm here to give a brief message from my quiet time. I just finished the book of Numbers, and I'm going to bring you a message from Numbers 23. The Israelites have just been sentenced to wander in the wilderness, and a couple chapters after that, Balaam the prophet comes into the picture. King Balak of Moab is anxious about the Israelites, and he calls on Balaam to curse the Israelites. And we're not, the text is left ambiguous as to whether or not Balaam is a benevolent prophet, one of the Lord, or is somewhere more on the not so great side. But what is clear is that if that even is the case, that Balaam could not help but to bring the truth of God's word. Numbers 23, verse 18. This was the message Balaam delivered. "Rise up, Balak, and listen. Hear me, son of Zippor. God is not a man, so he does not lie. He is not human, so he does not change his mind. Has he ever spoken and failed to act? Has he ever promised and not carried it through? Listen, I received a command to bless. God has blessed, and I cannot reverse it. No misfortune is in his plan for Jacob. No trouble is in store for Israel, for the Lord their God is with them. He has been proclaimed their king. God brought them out of Egypt. For them, he is as strong as a wild ox. No curse can touch Jacob. No magic has any power against Israel. For now it will be said of Jacob, what wonders God has done for Israel." And no better point can be taken out of this text than from the text itself in verse 20, where Balaam says, "Listen, I received a command to bless. God has blessed, and I cannot reverse it." Everything is in the Lord's hands. Curses, blessings, all of it. So as you go throughout your week, as you go even throughout your day, remember that it's hardly in your control at all. And that ultimately it's up to God. And I don't know about you, but that is very comforting to me. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that, Andrew. I believe that your brother Adam would agree with that. He would say you did a good job there. Let's continue to sing. You know, our first hymn was about the Word of God, and we have another great hymn about that. It's more, this one we're about to sing, a little bit more modern, just written just a few years ago. But I hope you'll pick up on what's being said here as we sing. Would you stand again, please, as we sing together?
Turns up.
Well, I am filling in for the prayer today for Brother Joe Don as he and Miranda are working in the nursery. So let me take this opportunity, as I do when I fill in for him here, that if you are not currently involved in working with our kids, this is the perfect time to do that. Right now, if you're on the nursery rotation, it's about once every 6 weeks. And so if some of you who God is calling to be a part of that ministry, if you guys sign up, it'll be 7-8 weeks, something like that. We're blessed. And those who work with the kids, but let me just say, and especially to you younger grandparents, those of you who are in condition, right? You're used to this. You're in shape for these little ones. You're the ones that need to be back there. Those kids will love to get to know you and to have you minister to them. They will remember you forever. I still remember the ladies who were in the nursery when I was little. I can see them clear as day spraying Lysol in the air. I can see it. I can see Miss Barry Hill as clear as if she was standing here doing that. I understand why. It was the nursery. But anyway, but if you're not involved in that, let me encourage you to do so. Well, guys, I'm going to pray for us. And then after I pray, we have children's church up through fourth grade. So kids, you can head to the back and then head to the children's area for that. But let me pray for us. Father, we praise you for your grace, your mercy, your perfection. Jesus, we praise you as our Lord, as our Savior. Holy Spirit, we praise you as the one who empowers us, as the one whose ministry it is to glorify Christ. Father, forgive us when we sin against you. Father, forgive our sins. Cleanse us today that we would worship you as pure vessels. Father, I thank you for the Sunday school hour that just took place. I thank you for the baptisms that we celebrated. I thank you for those who are working in the nursery today, those who are working in children's church and junior children's church. And I thank you for those watching online and those who are here in the room. Father, I pray now that you would continue to just empower us and fill us with your Spirit, Lord, to worship you in everything that we do. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you so much, choir. And I do want to say, before I get started, I want to thank everybody. Y'all only see a small sliver of what happens for baptism, but there is so much going on logistically in the back to get people ready and make sure none of us trip and fall and, you know, all that kind of stuff. I just want to thank everybody who's involved with all that goes on with baptisms. It starts on Saturday because you got to fill that thing up and run the heater and all of that. And so thank you guys who are involved. Now, let me say also, if you're a guest here with us today, I didn't say this at the beginning, if you'd like some more information about our church, it's real easy to do. In the pew in front of you, you'll see a guest card. You can fill that card out, and as you leave today, as you go out into the foyer there at the Welcome Center in the middle of the room, in the hall there, there's a basket for tithes and offerings. You can drop that in there, and we can respond with a phone call or email, or you can just send me an email to John, J-O-H-N, at mycbcc.org, and hopefully I can answer any questions that you might have. We are in the middle of a series that really is very important to our church. If you weren't here last week, I encourage you to go back to Facebook or YouTube. It's in both places, and watch at least the first part of last week's sermon. In that sermon, in the beginning, I threw out some fairly sobering statistics about our church. There's two that really caught everybody's attention. One I need to clarify. Many of you have come up to me this week and said, "Did I hear you say that the average age of our church is 81. It is not. However, 81 is the most frequent age at our church. So if we did a survey in the room, more people would be 81 than any other age in the entire church. But we also have two-year-olds, so the average, you know, tends to come together. But the one that we really focused on is the fact that within our Sunday school roster, which is a little under 400 people as far as enrolled in Sunday school, we don't have that many come, that next generation of leaders, that age between 21 and 40, those who in 20 years will be 41 to 60, that should be in 20 years from now, should be the leaders in the church, the committee chairs and deacon chairs and all of that, that within that group, within our Sunday school roster, only 6% of our church falls into that number. And that is actually not even completely correct either. Because of those 25 people that 6% represents, about 12 of them have been on the rolls for a long time, but they don't attend anymore. So that number is actually more like 3 or 4%. And so we are not effectively reaching the next generation of leaders. And so we're talking about those things. And what I have been saying and what I'm going to ask the church to do, starting in February with the advisory council meeting and the first Sunday, is I'm going to be presenting a vision team and asking the church to approve a vision team for us to begin to work through and say, what do we need to do now? Because we're 25 years old, we're healthy, the Lord is blessing our church. What do we need to do now to just make some little adjustments along the way so that 25 years from now, when we're 50, we're still healthy and we're still seeing people saved and we're still seeing the Lord move among us? So that's what we started last week. And we asked the question, why does the church exist? And we saw that the church exists to make disciples. It's very clear from the Great Commission text in Matthew. Well, I want to ask this question this week. What are we meant to do? How do we do church? What does church actually consist of? Because we all have in our minds what we think church ought to be. What are we actually supposed to do? Well, fortunately, the Bible does not leave us without guidance. And so I saw many of you have already turned. If you haven't already turned to it, turn to Acts chapter 2 and verse 42. We're going to look at a foundational paragraph. This is one of the most important paragraphs in the New Testament, one of the most important paragraphs in all of the Bible. Here's what's just happened. Jesus he has now ascended into heaven. He's been gone for, I don't know, 10 days or so, and because he spent 40 days here on earth. He was raised from the dead on Easter. He spends about 40 days here on earth. 10 days after that, about 50 days after Easter, is the day of Pentecost. On the day of Pentecost, the believers are gathered together in the upper room. The Holy Spirit falls. You'll remember this from Acts chapter 2. The flames of fire above their head, and they start to speak in other tongues. And those tongues are known languages that they don't know. And so they end up going to the temple area, and they're sharing the gospel, and they're preaching the gospel, and crowds gather, and they're amazed. They're like, we're hearing these words in our own native language. And so as the crowd gathers, Peter steps up and takes over and preaches a sermon. It's one of the great sermons, one of the most important sermons in all of the Bible. In Acts chapter 2, 3,000 people come to faith in Christ in one day. That's a pretty big invitation. I don't know how many times they had to sing the verses in Just As I Am, but it went on for a while. Okay, 3,000 people came to faith in Christ. So that's just happened. Luke, the author of Acts, backs up, steps out of the narrative, and gives us a summary. He does this a couple times in the book, and this is one of the most important ones. He's going to give us a summary of how these people did church. This is before conflict comes. It's only going to be a couple chapters before conflict comes. So people are going to lie about some stuff, and God's going to strike them dead. You know, that's just Acts chapter 5. But here in Acts chapter 2, everything is working exactly like it's supposed to. So let's see what it says. Acts chapter 2, verse 42 through 47. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, and to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. What are we meant to do? Well, verse 42 addresses that. Verse 42 tells us, here's what we do when we gather together. This is what a local church is supposed to do. Notice how it starts. This is the foundation. It's the Word of God. It says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Now, what did that consist of, the apostles' teachings? Well, it would have consisted of all the things that Jesus would have taught the apostles during his time here on earth. And in that time, especially after he was raised from the dead, he would have explained to them how the Old Testament, what you and I call the Old Testament, their Bible, that's all they had. They didn't have the New Testament yet because they were living it. So all they had was Genesis to Malachi. And he took that and he taught them how that pointed to him. So they would have been teaching the Old Testament scriptures. They would have been teaching all the things that they heard Jesus say over the years, the Sermon on the Mount. They would have been telling the stories that ultimately were recorded in the Gospels. They would have been talking about how all these things apply to their lives. So basically, they were verbally teaching what would become the New Testament. So when it talks about the apostles' teachings, just simply think the Bible. And so here these folks are completely devoted, and the idea is continually devoting themselves to several things, and the very first thing is the Word of God. If we don't get this right, nothing else matters. If we abandon the Word of God, if we don't follow the Word of God, if we don't believe the Word of God, then why in the world do we even gather together on Sundays? That's the thing that is consistent. If you and I could go back in time 100 years, we'd feel a little out of place in a worship service. It wouldn't look like our worship service. It wouldn't sound like our worship service. But if they were faithful to the Word of God, when the pastor got up to preach, you'd think, okay, I'm home. If you go back 200 years, the same thing would happen. If you go back 300 years, the same thing would happen. Everything else might look a little different, but the message, the Word, is eternal. That's the first thing they're doing. They're devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. And then there's some things that flow out of that. It says, and to the fellowship. Now, what's the first thing you think of when I say the word fellowship? Food. Eating. Right? This is why I'm convinced these first believers were Baptists, because you're going to see that food is all over this paragraph, right? But this is so much more than that. This has the idea of community. This has the idea of oneness. This has the idea of them being together, of sharing things in common. This means genuine relationships. Not just surfacey stuff, not just, hey, how you doing, we're fine, all that sort of stuff. This is actually being together and supporting one another in life. Because the little word "the" is there in front. I don't know if your translation has it, but literally, mine does. In the original, it says, devoting to the fellowship, so the fellowship of other believers. So they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, and then here's some more food, to the breaking of bread. Now, what's that? Well, a couple things. Number one, most people think it refers in general to them having meals together. It's mentioned later in the paragraph. But within those meals, they would then have and celebrate the Lord's Supper together. So they worshiped together. When they were gathered together, it was a time of worship. It was a time of service. So they're worshiping God. They've gathered together in the temple. They gather together in homes. We see this all throughout the paragraph. This is what they're doing. They're breaking bread together. They are worshiping together. They're spending time together. And they're praying together. Look at the verse again. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Most likely that means they went to the temple. This is still very much a Jewish context. They would have gone to the temple several times a day for the official prayer times. They would have been doing that together. And then as they were in homes, as they were in the marketplace, as they were doing all of these things, they would have been praying together. So do you see, this is the picture of the early church. They're surrounded and completely committed to God's word. They're completely committed to one another, and they're worshiping together. That's who we have to be. That's who you and I are called to be. And it all starts with the Word of God. And here's what I want us to understand. If we're going to reach those who we are not reaching, the thing we have to make sure is that we as a church are absolutely healthy. Because healthy things are what grows. I don't know about y'all, but we've got some plants in our yard that we think the ice and snow a couple weeks ago might have just taken out. Right, and we're not too sad about it, actually. These are some things that we're thinking we need to get rid of those anyway. So, you know, we're going to get out there when it dries up with something and just knock it all down. You know, it's going to be a lot of fun to watch Donna do that. And I'll take pictures. But healthy things grow, right? These things aren't healthy anymore. When a church does what a church is supposed to do, God then begins to use that church, and he begins to bless that church. He begins to trust that church with his babies, with new believers. So this is what we're meant to do. That's verse 42. Now what happens, the next question is, what happens when we do what we're meant to? What happens? Well, the first thing is this. We will see God move. Look at verse 43. Look at the results. And awe, or fear, came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. Miracles are an interesting thing. Miracles really only happen in three major parts of the Bible. Now, there's a few sprinkled in some different places, but for the most part, you'll find miracles during the time of the Exodus, during the time of Elijah and Elisha, and during the time of Jesus in the first part of the book of Acts. There are a few scattered in other places throughout the Bible, but those are the three main times we see a lot of miracles. And the miracles were here during this time because it validated the message. The miracle always points to the message. It never points to the miracle. It never points to itself. A miracle is never to draw attention to itself. The miracle says what this person is saying is absolutely true. And we have an example of that in the very next chapter. Peter and John are going to the temple. And in Acts chapter 3 and verse 6, it says this. But Peter said, I have no silver and gold, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. God began to do something. He began to move among this church. They began to see people heal. They began to see people save. They just had 3,000 people come to faith in Christ. And just a few chapters later, we're going to get a word that 5,000 people have now come to faith in Christ. When you and I are doing what we're called to do, God is going to move. He is going to work among us. Now, what does that mean? That means that as a church, we're going to see marriages healed. It means we're going to see relationships that have been broken restored. It means we're going to see lost people saved. It means that we're going to see people going from being a baby Christian to being a leader in the church. It means we're going to see God do things that the only explanation is that he did it. But we have to put ourselves in that position. We have to be healthy. We have to be doing what he has called us to do. We will see God move. But not only will we see God move, we'll also take care of one another. We will care for one another. Look at verse 44. And all who believed were together. That's related to what it says in verse 42 about fellowship. And had all things in common. Now, let me pause here. Don't get worried. This is not some weird socialist experiment. You'll see in a minute this is voluntary among the people when needs arise. So verse 45 explains it. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all, and here's why, as any had need. So just like we're to influence those outside of our church, and we see that in this paragraph, part of our calling, part of the thing that you and I are meant to do is to take care of one another, to make sure that we're provided for. I see this happen all the time. As pastor, I get to view this probably more than anybody else, because people often will come to me and say, I know about this. I know about what's going on with this person, with this family. How can we help them? And sometimes we go, there's a line item there in our designated funds, this benevolent fund. And that money is sitting there so that we can help people. We've helped people with, you know, house notes and car payments, and bad things have happened to them, and all of that sort of stuff. That's within the church. I've seen over and over again where Sunday school classes will step up to help one another out. I've seen it where the entire church will step up to help someone out. This happens constantly. This is us as a church making sure, because we are a family, we have chosen to be together, making sure that we are taking care of one another. And that's exactly what's happening here. People were selling things so that they could provide for others, for the people that had need. Now, that's going to get them, there's some people that are going to lie about it. The ones I mentioned a minute ago, when you get to chapter 5, that God strikes dead. The reason he does that is because they sell some stuff and they lie about it. And ultimately, he takes them out because of that. But this is genuinely taking care of one another. This is not us saying, well, I'll pray for you, and then not doing anything about it. It's us, let me pray with you, and let's figure out how we can help you. I've seen it over and over again. It's one of the things that we are called to do. We will care for one another. So we'll see God move. We'll care for one another. What's the next thing we see? Well, it's simply this. We will unite joyfully. When you and I are doing what we're meant to do, the joy in our lives and the joy that comes from being united is only obvious. It's nothing but obvious to the rest of the world. Look at the description, verse 46. And day by day, notice it just doesn't say Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Day by day, attending the temple together, so they're worshiping together, and breaking bread in their homes, so their lives are intimately connected. They receive their food, once again, we know they were Baptist, right? They're eating all over this chapter, with glad and generous hearts. Did you hear that? Glad and generous hearts. There's joy in their life. And notice the response, praising God and having favor with all the people. Do you realize, you and I, if you've repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus Christ, you should be one of the happiest people on the planet. Amen. You should. Which then, you then ask the question, well, what about the grumpy believer? Right? There's a couple of responses to the grumpy believer. One, either they're not a believer, and that's their grumpiness, or if they weren't saved, they'd be a whole lot more grumpy. That's an option too, right? Because we all tend, often salvation, we still deal with who we are, you know, even after we're saved. So sometimes you have some of that. But the description here is these people, they are glad and they're generous with their hearts and who they are. In fact, you'll remember in Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Here's what I want you to understand. That generation that we're not doing a good job of reaching can spot phoniness from a mile away. And if our relationships with one another don't have genuine gladness and joy, why in the world would they commit to something like that? Why would they commit to something that isn't genuine? Why would they commit to something that isn't real? We don't all have to be best buddies. We're too big of a church for that. Our church is just to the size. Some of y'all over here don't know these folks over here, and vice versa. It happens. Once you get to about over 150 or so, it just doesn't happen. It's part of that size. That's okay. But you need to be plugged into a Sunday school class. You need to have genuine friends within the church, people that support you and support one another. And when you come together, when we come together, that fellowship is one of genuine joy, one of genuine gladness, so that we can show the world the gospel makes a difference. It's not just surfacey stuff. It's actually loving one another and taking care of one another. So we get all this stuff together. We'll see God move. We'll care for one another. We'll be united joyfully when we do what we're meant to do. And what's the last thing? We'll reach the lost. We will reach the lost. Look at verse 47. Praising God and having favor with all the people. And then this is Luke, who's a great writer, saves this for last. And the Lord added to their number, only at the end of the invitation on Sunday morning, those who are being saved. That's not what it says. Day by day. Some of these people had the audacity to get saved on a Tuesday. Day by day. See, they're living their life. They're you know, going to the market during the day. They're having people in their home. They're having genuine fellowship. And lost people who don't know the Lord are seeing that. And they're seeing what these folks are doing. And they're, every single day, somebody is coming to faith in Christ. That's the picture. When you and I do what we are meant to do, when we are genuinely devoted to God's word, when we are devoted to one another, when we are worshiping together, lost people are going to see that. And they're going to see, they might say in their heart and mind, I don't believe what they believe, but man, they sure believe it. And then the Holy Spirit gets a hold of them, begins to convict them and draw them and show them that they're lost and show them that they need to be saved. And they know it's real. They know that it's genuine with us. And they repent of their sins and place their faith in Jesus Christ. And we get to fill this thing with water all the time. I would love for those who work in the baptistry area to be sick of those steps. Like I'm so, by the way, if you've never been up those steps, they're not easy. It's high up there. I'd love for our ordinance committee to say, I cannot believe we're having to fill, I'm so, you know, fill this thing every single week. No, they wouldn't do that. They'd be excited about it. But can you imagine seeing those kind of numbers, seeing us having to fill that baptistry every week or maybe just every other week or even just once a month, seeing lost people come to faith in Christ. Do y'all remember Randy Davis stood right here, the executive director of Tennessee Baptist Convention, and when he preached last year, he did our men's conference, and he got up here, and he does this, I think, everywhere he goes. He gets the statistics for the churches, and he talked about all the money that our church has given over the 25 years. Some of you remember this because you said it to me. And when we saw the finances, we were like, wow, look what God has done. Several million dollars given to missions. But then he gave a number that caused all of us to stop a little short. You remember this? Over 25 years, the number of baptisms was 65. Now, praise God for those 65. But for the most part, our church has been a church of transfer growth. For the most part, most of you, including me, came here having already come to faith in Christ, having already been baptized, already a member of another church, and that's how our church has grown over the years. And praise the Lord that we're together. I said last week, I have no doubt that our church can do what it needs to do to reach the next generation, because I know y'all, you love Jesus and you love this church and you want to see God do something here. But we historically have not been very effective at reaching the lost. And that can change very easily if you and I will simply live out what God has called us to live. And when we have those opportunities to tell somebody, well, yeah, I wasn't a Christian either, but let me tell you what Jesus did for me. And talk about before you were saved, and talk about how you were saved, and talk about after you were saved. That's how you give a Christian testimony. Or just opening up the Bible and saying, look at John 3:16. For God so loved the world. And tell them what Jesus did for them. and tell them that whosoever, that whoever believes in him, and that they can believe in him, and they'll have eternal life. You don't need to know this. It's good to know a way to share the gospel. It's good to have the system. It's good to have all these verses memorized, but all you really need is John 3:16, and most of us know it. And just share that with somebody. Day by day, seeing people saved. Can you imagine? That's what we could see if we simply do what we're meant to do. So let's go back to the question. What are we meant to do? Well, it's Acts chapter 2 and verse 42, the very first verse. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. When we do that, we're going to see God move. We're going to see unity. We're going to see people come to faith in Christ. So let's dream for a minute. Just picture our church 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 15 years from now, 6 months from now, whatever it is, where we're seeing young couples come in here with their kids. They're coming to faith in Christ. We're seeing them go from being someone who is just learning the Word of God to where later down the road that he's a deacon and she's serving in all these areas and we see them grow in their faith and we see them discipling others and we see their kids get saved and we see their kids serving the Lord and we see what God is doing. Can you picture a church where your kids and your grandkids want to sit with you on Sunday morning and worship with you here? Because they've come to faith in Jesus Christ. Listen, there is absolutely nothing on paper, nothing that holds our church back. As far as the non-spiritual stuff goes, we have some of the best facilities I've ever seen. Some of the best. You can't argue about location. Tens of thousands of cars drive past our church every single day. Half of them turn around the parking lot. I can see them from my office. They do. I don't know where these people are going, that they got to completely go the other direction. Right? It doesn't make any sense to me, but that's what happens. We have an incredible staff. Guys, Adam and Jodon and Bill are so good at what they do. I mean, it's amazing. There is absolutely nothing holding us back. All we have to do is say, okay, Lord, we're here. We're willing. Use us. Can you imagine this room getting so crowded we've got to go to two services? Can you imagine Sunday school getting so crowded we have to go to two Sunday schools? Can you imagine having to expand the parking lot because we can't fit? I mean, that's what the Lord does that. There's no reason to think he can't do that here. And it has nothing to do with the numbers. Numbers are great. Preachers love numbers, but it's really about lives that are changed. It's about lost people being saved, and it's about saved people being discipled and maturing in their faith and living it out. Amen. That's what we can do. That's what I hope you can see where we're going. If you're here today and you're not a believer, if you're not a Christian, I want you to, that very last part of verse 47, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being, and then the word is saved. The word means rescued. If you've never been saved, if you're not part of their number, if you're not part of the kingdom of God, repent of your sins, place your faith in Jesus Christ, and be saved. That's what we see here in this description, is people who are not Christians becoming Christians. If you've never given your life to Christ today, call on the name of the Lord and be saved. I want to challenge our church members, though, those in the room, those who might be watching. God absolutely wants to use us. That's his nature. He wants to use his people. And so what I want us to do today is just begin to say, Lord, we don't know what this looks like. We don't know where we're going, but we just want you to use us. Use us for your kingdom and for your glory. And during the invitation, just say, Lord, okay, I'm yours. I'll do what you want us to do. And notice how I said that. What he wants us to do. Not what the preacher wants us to do. Not what the staff wants us to do. Not what the deacons want us to do. Not what the Sunday school teachers want us to do. All those things are important and they're involved in things. But ultimately, if we don't do what God wants us to do, we're wasting our time. and we're being disobedient to him. So today, let's just surrender ourselves and say, Lord, your will, we will absolutely do it. So we're going to have our time of response. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, be saved. Come talk to me. And in the next few weeks, if you give your life to Christ, the water's already in there. We won't baptize you today. Don't worry. We'll drain it right after service. But we'll fill it back up. And we'll baptize you so you can tell the whole world you've come to faith in Christ. But today, if you know him, just simply surrender and say, Lord, whatever you want, that's what I'll do. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for inspiring Luke to write this paragraph to summarize what we see in the early church. I pray for us as a church that we would seek your will in every way and at all times. Lord, I thank you for everyone here. I thank you for the love that this church has for you, has for one another. Lord, I thank you for the concern for souls. I thank you for how you have blessed us. Lord, just give us wisdom to continue to serve you. Father, we thank you for loving us. We ask you to move during this time. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.